welcome to the Jerrell Riggins Show, the program that explores various subjects, including business, mental health, music, technology, and current events. I am your host, Jerrell Riggins. Today we have in the studio with us, Lauren Grymek, Director of Economic Development for City of Melrose. Welcome.
Hi, thank you for having me.
Oh, before we begin the interview, could you please share a little bit about your background and for our listening audience?
Sure, you bet. My position is a new position with the City of Melrose. I've just passed my one-year anniversary, so right. Honeymoon's over, as they say. Thank you. It's a position that Mayor Broder formed using some of the city's ARPA, the American Rescue Plan Act recovery money. It's funded for 3 years. Hopefully I can stay on after that and do a good job. But prior to that, I ran the Melrose Chamber of Commerce for 5 years. So very familiar with Melrose and the business community, and I'm also a resident here. So
okay.
Yes, I know a little bit about this town.
All right, that's good. Do you have any tips you want to share for others if they want to start their own business or...
Sure. I say to everyone, you know, a lot of business owners start with like the dream and the vision, and that's mm-hmm. where the passion comes to put in all the hard work. But you do need to put pen to paper, as they say, in my generation, and write a business plan and think about your financials. That's the stuff that a lot of people don't want to think about. But mm-hmm. at the end of the day, that's the stuff you really need to start with is to think about those things.
So have a mission, vision statement. Lay this out, your branding, how you're marketing.
Absolutely, absolutely. And just your general business plan. And even, you know, even if it's a basic one sheet, like a budget, you know, just to get that in there.
Oh, that's great. Now, if we want to highlight some businesses here in Melrose, any particular ones that have just started? I know I've been down to Biddy and Bowes.
Yep. Yeah, we're pretty great. You know, what I love about Melrose is we have a mix of what I call legacy businesses, those businesses that have been here forever, like Hugo's and Gray's Appliances. Who would have thought we'd have two appliance stores in one place? You know, certainly the Turners, many of our pizza shops, but then we have some new businesses. We have a brand new bookstore that just opened, Molly's Bookstore. We have Yara Chocolates, which opened, you know, shortly after the pandemic started. Waggery on Main for, you know, anyone that owns a pet, and countless others. And I think it's a great mix of sort of, you know, where we've been as in our history, and then, you know, some of these new uses coming in as the demographics change in the community.
Oh, do you see any more new businesses forming and branching out here in the City of Melrose?
That's a good question, because that's definitely part of my job is to attract new businesses to open up here and to support those businesses looking to open up here. I think the great problem that we have right now is just a low inventory of commercial space available, especially storefronts.
Okay.
You know, you go to some downtowns across the state and across the country, and they're desolate. That's not the case with ours, you know, in some of our other business districts. We have a hard time trying to find spaces for businesses, but certainly we would love to see, and have been talking to different restaurant uses to try to vary our restaurant scene, as well as some more retail, because we know that that attracts foot traffic, and foot traffic for one business is good foot traffic for another business.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned a business plan. What about like a SWOT analysis, knowing their strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats?
Well, you know your stuff. And, you know, I would say that is certainly, if you don't know where to start with the business plan and with the financials, that's a perfect place to start with. Mm-hmm. Because once you know that, that will help you understand, is this even something that you can and should move forward with? Okay. So I always recommend that to people.
So you really need to know your target market.
Absolutely.
Your competition.
And not even your target market, but is your target market going to come to where you open up? You know, so understanding the local market as well.
Okay. Now, I mean, given the COVID-19 pandemic, do you see more people doing more remote type businesses, virtual?
Sure. You know, we have certainly seen a little bit of that, those at-home businesses, folks who've said, you know what, I did this in the corporate world, and if the pandemic taught me anything, it's that, you know, I don't want that lifestyle anymore, or I'm ready to try something new. So mm-hmm. if not now, then when? You know, but I will say too that there's different risks associated with that as well. You know, for a lot of people, you have to have that luxury of having, you know, someone else in the household that maybe carries health insurance or can bring home additional, you know, mm-hmm. kind of steady income as you're building that at-home business. Or you have to have, you know, had such a track record that you have customers and a client base to start with. But we've certainly seen that, you know, especially here in Melrose, where people are just, you know, trying something new, you know, as a result of what that pandemic taught them.
Oh, okay. That leads me into my next question. So what skills and qualifications should these business owners have to start that business?
Sure. I mean, you said it best at the beginning, like having, I think, that vision and passion is certainly first and foremost, because at the end of the day, that's going to get you through the low times when the money's not coming in. That's going to get you through, you know, the repairs when the roof mm-hmm. is leaking and things like that. But I think it's important to have a little bit of a sense of financial acumen. And I mean, even if you can at least do your own, you know, home budget, at least have some sense of that. A little bit of legal knowledge or doing a little legal research doesn't help. Mm-hmm. And what I've always said to people is, if you don't think you can do those things, it's worth it to invest in someone who can. A general accountant, a local attorney, someone who can give you that advice. And I think what's great about a place like Melrose is you can find some of those services where you can have a cup of coffee with someone before they're going to start, you know, charging you and, mm-hmm. and really.
Oh, that's great.
But it is an investment to make if you don't have those skills.
Yeah, because I mean, if you, especially at the at-home business, you probably want to have somebody to tell you, do you need an LLC, corporation to protect your personal assets? So if something does go wrong, you don't have someone attached in your house.
Right, right. Absolutely. You know, I mean, some people just don't know where to start. So being able to have, you know, someone that can tell you that. I mean, in addition, I love to tell people about the Small Business Administration, the SBA. Mm-hmm. They're a great resource. We also here in our area have something called SCORE, which is completely free services to small businesses. And all of the people who volunteer for SCORE were once super professionals in their life. So we've got retired CFOs, retired, you know, marketing experts, people that will help you put together your business plan, help you find funding sources, talk about what type of, you know, business, you know, you should mm-hmm. set up.
Where is the SCORE office located here in Melrose?
So we don't have one here in Melrose, but there is one that is in Stoneham. And a lot of times now, again, as a result of the pandemic, mm-hmm. these mentors, they're called mentors and coaches, will meet with you virtually. And we're lucky enough to have actually a Melrose resident. Her name is Diana Wernberg. You might know her from the farmer's market, who's kind of my local SCORE person. So she's wonderful to work with.
Great. Yeah. That's good. That's good information. What are some of you think are the most challenging part of starting a small business from your perspective?
I would say probably the thing that I hear the most is financing and mm-hmm. funding opportunities, and just having that, you know, capital to, whether it's to sign a lease, whether you might be purchasing a real estate to operate your business, maybe you need to invest in equipment. You know, if you're opening a small restaurant, think of how expensive appliances are. And so I think that that can be the most daunting thing, but it's mm-hmm. not a challenge that can't be overcome. Oh. There are definitely small business loan opportunities. We've got some great banks here in Melrose that will work with, you know, businesses to get them that working capital, low interest loans, and things like that. So it's definitely available.
Oh, okay. Do you think there are any added challenges for a business owner if she's a woman or a minority getting started?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think it's definitely something that's not, you know, really in my world to say. And it's mm-hmm. it's easy for me to, you know, to say no. I think that here in Melrose, you know, we welcome that. But I do understand that, you know, outside of Melrose and even in our own country, there is still a lot of obstacles for a woman or a minority-owned business owner to face that may not have those loans readily available, that mm-hmm. financing, may not have access to those legal experts. So I do think it varies. I think, again, here in Melrose, we are lucky to have lucky to not have to face that. And what I've actually seen here in Massachusetts, again, as there was a great benefit of the pandemic, was that recognizing that there was inequalities amongst, you know, our small business owners and our economy, and being able to set up programs in which women-owned businesses and minority-owned businesses are prioritized, or in some cases, even the only ones who qualify for certain mm-hmm. grant and loan programs. So I think in Massachusetts, there are programs here specifically for women-owned and minority-owned businesses. Yeah.
What type of financial resources, I know you mentioned a little bit earlier, that's available to these startup businesses?
Sure. So a lot of times you've got, you see like a loan, low interest loans, or in some cases, you know, loans that don't have to be repaid for a long time. Oh. There's a lot of grant opportunities out there now. Grants, of course, are considered taxable income, but don't have to be repaid. And I think that, you know, sometimes you see kind of a mix of both. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, you've got, you know, people that just decide they're going to try to, you know, put in as much of their own, you know, money as they can to do it. But there's such a variety of programming. And again, you can start really with your local bank, wherever you have, you know, your personal banking. Okay. I would start there and ask what kind of business banking programs they have available.
Okay. What are some of the new projects and things you're looking for as you for the rest of 2023 and building up that business community?
Yep. Well, one part of my job is also focusing on the continued recovery for our local businesses. Mm-hmm. And the mayor has authorized a small business grant program, which I'm currently in the midst of issuing grants to some of our local businesses to just give them that extra financial boost so they mm-hmm. have it and can feel that the city is supporting them. So I'll continue that program mm-hmm. until our funding runs out for it through 2023. And then I'm also overseeing a new initiative by the city, which is called Project Pop-Up. So using state funds that we were granted, we are popping up entrepreneurs and small businesses at a storefront located on West Emerson Street, which is next to Bohemian Coffee Shop and the Alfredo's Pizza Kitchen, which is being renovated. And what I love about that project is we're able to support small brands and entrepreneurs that may not have that capital or that access to lease out a space, you know, mm-hmm. say like where we are here today in the MMTV building for a long period of time. It allows them to test their market, test their products out in a space, and determine, you know, if they can, you know, build their own space. And a great example of this program is a business called the Mothership of All Design. They were part of our first project pop-up. They produce sweatshirts and t-shirts and, you know, kind of our Melrose spirit gear, if you will.
All right.
And he went from running the business in his basement to being part of our temporary project, pop-up project, and now has his own space right behind Eastern Bank that he leases mm-hmm. himself. And so it was a great option for him to, again, test the market, grow his wings a little bit, and now he's fled the nest.
Wow, that's great. So that's more like an incubator.
Exactly. Yep. Okay. That's a great way to describe it.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
So now with this incubator, do they have access to like maybe have the mailing address, phone, all of that as well as part of the service or?
Yep. Yep. They definitely do. The program, if they're accepted, includes marketing support, website support. It includes a rent stipend to help pay. So what's great is the commercial landlord that we worked with, their part was they put in some improvements to the space, you know, new flooring, painting the walls, new lighting, really brightening it up. They're able to still get sort of a market rate rent, you know, so they don't feel like they're missing out. But those tenants are subsidized with this mm-hmm. grant that we got from the state, so they don't feel like they're taking on this huge amount of rent to risk all of that. So.
Oh, that's great. So it's a win-win for everybody.
I think it is. And it would have been an otherwise vacant storefront. So in that block of businesses, again, Bohemian, Yara Chocolate, Perella Jewelers, the music shop, the soon-to-reopen Alfredo's Pizza Kitchen, that would be, you know, the last missing link. And we've filled that space for at least a year with these
great
pop-ups. Hopefully they'll stay after that on their own.
Oh, yeah. A lot of foot traffic coming through there. That's
great.
Yep,
exactly.
Given the large number of employees that are not returning to the corporate world, did you think that ignited a boom for the small business?
Yeah, I think here in Melrose, I think what we saw, and we were lucky a little bit, we were sort of I think, protected or sort of insulated from what we maybe saw in the major downtowns like Boston and Cambridge, where all of a sudden overnight they lost this huge, you know, worker population, the daytime population, who are now all at home. Well, guess what? A lot of those workers live right here in Melrose, or maybe you work in the North Shore or along the 128 belt. So now that people have been home, and quite frankly, a lot have either gone to a hybrid schedule or they're at least home some days, they're getting their coffee here, they're running their errands here, they're spending more time in Melrose in general, and that has benefited our business community, certainly. While they're still recovering and there's still some recovery to happen, I think that we were lucky in that sense that we are not, you know, we're not dependent upon outsider daytime commuter traffic.
Oh, that's great. Any last words of wisdom you'd like to share from...
Well, you know, I always, any chance I get, just tell people, you know, it does make a difference. Every purchase that you can make locally really does help a small business. Sometimes it means you have to, you know, wait a day because the business is not opened on Mondays, or sometimes you have to wait a week because the business doesn't have what you want. But it really does. Every purchase that we don't spend in Melrose does make a difference, and every purchase that we do makes a bigger and better difference.
Oh, great. Well, I want to say thank you again for being here with us today, and it's been a pleasure, and hopefully we can do this again and kind of check in and see how things are going later in the year.
I'd love it. I'd love to come back. Thank you for having me.
Great. Thank you for joining us. Stay tuned for our next podcast, and thank you for tuning in, and take care of yourself. Peace and blessings.